Hi everyone, I hope that you're staying safe during these times. I also hope that you found my last video on baby nutrition informative and helpful. I've had a few people messaging me asking for a similar video on the optimal nutrition for pregnancy, and so I am going to be discussing that today. As some of you may know, I actually found out that I was pregnant just a few days after I signed up for my nutrition program. So I took that as a sign from God, and the first thing I did was I dove right into the child nutrition portion of my program. And so I used those recommendations and modified my diet. And what I will be sharing with you today is those exact same recommendations. And so stay tuned. Every expecting parent that I know wants a healthy baby. That is pretty much the one ask that every parent has. And I'm sure if you are here listening to this video, that means you know that part of that comes from nutrition. What you may not know, however, is that it starts from preconception. So the type of food that we eat has an impact on our baby's health before they are even conceived. If both parents have a nutrient-dense diet prior to conception, then the preparation period is quite short. It could be as short as 6 months. However, if both parents are following a standard American diet or a vegan diet, a vegetarian diet, or a low-fat diet, then it may take a longer preparation time. That could be up to 2 to 3 years in order to make sure that the body has restored all of the depleted nutrients. So during this preparation time, as well as during pregnancy and during breastfeeding, the focus should be on nutrient-dense foods. So those are things like eggs, butter, meat, liver, bone broth, all from grass-fed or pasture-raised animals. In addition, it's important to consume seafood, lacto-fermented foods, as well as coconut oil, whole grains, and vegetables and fruits. And most importantly, cod liver oil for its vitamin A content. And lastly, which I'm sure is a surprise to most of you, raw milk. That is, if you have access to it. Yep, I know. You were probably told avoid vitamin A, so avoid cod liver oil, avoid liver because of the vitamin A content. And you were probably also told to avoid seafood because of its mercury content. And raw dairy? Isn't that dangerous for anybody? Especially people that are pregnant? And why is the focus on animal products? Shouldn't it be on whole grains, vegetables, fruits? I know, I thought the same thing. So let me explain why that's not the case. As I was preparing for this video, I realized that the video was going to be super long. So what I've done is I have split it into two parts. So today we will go over all of the food items that we've been told to avoid. So all of the forbidden foods. And then in part two, I'll go over all of the other recommended nutrients and food items. So first, let me explain why vitamin A is actually beneficial, despite what you may have heard. And that's because vitamin A is important for the development of the organs and systems. The reason it's important is that it regulates the differentiation of primitive cells into the corresponding organs. Basically, it signals for each cell, telling them what type of cell they should be and what sort of tissue they should become. So if we did not have sufficient vitamin A in our system, the cells that are supposed to become heart tissue would not know to become heart tissue, and those that are supposed to be liver tissue would not know to become liver tissue. And so vitamin A is actually quite crucial for the development of organs and systems. And in fact, once these organs and systems are developed, vitamin A is also important for their growth. So if vitamin A is lacking, any of these organs and systems could develop abnormally. In addition, vitamin A also signals for our body to be symmetrical on the outside, because on the inside, where our body is completely asymmetrical, if you know where your heart, liver, kidneys, where everything is, there's no symmetry internally. But on the external, we are symmetrical. And so vitamin A is responsible for that signaling as well. Otherwise, we would have one arm that's shorter than the other, and so on and so forth. So again, vitamin A is quite crucial for the development of our body, our organs, our systems. So the link between vitamin A and birth defects is mind-boggling, because it's the use of vitamin A in our bodies is actually to do quite the opposite. It's to ensure that we do not have birth defects. So where did this data come from that shows that vitamin A is linked to birth defects, and why are we being told to avoid vitamin A? Well, it looks like that research came out of a study where it compared women who were taking vitamin A fortified foods or vitamin A supplements. And so it did not look at women that were taking vitamin A from natural sources. It was from synthetically created supplements and food items. So that could be where the problem is, because studies since then have shown that supplementation of vitamin A through natural sources of up to 20,000 IU is not only safe, but it's actually beneficial during pregnancy. And again, as I explained earlier, it actually protects from birth defects rather than leading to birth defects. What could be a problem is actually supplementing vitamin A without vitamin D. And when I say supplementing, I just want to make it clear that I am not referring to synthetic supplements. This could be natural supplements or natural food items that are rich in vitamin A, which I will go over later, but I just want to make that clear. So if you are supplementing vitamin A without vitamin D, then there could be a problem, because there would be a deficiency in vitamin D, and that could lead to bone problems. That could be bone problems to you or to the fetus. So that is to be noted. And the ratio of vitamin A to vitamin D should be 10 to 1. And this is why the best choice for supplementing vitamin A is cod liver oil, because cod liver oil contains vitamin A and vitamin D in that ratio, or in a ratio of 8 to 1, which is still good. And additionally, cod liver oil also contains omega-3, which is important for the brain and nervous system development of the baby. Cod liver oil is also good for men to take prior to conception, and that is because vitamin A is an antioxidant and can help with protecting the sperm from environmental toxins and any sort of environmental damage. I am speaking from experience. I took cod liver oil while I was pregnant. I did not inform my midwife or the doctors, because I knew that they often warn you against vitamin A supplementation. I did my own research, and I believed that that was good for the health of my baby. So I took vitamin A supplements during my pregnancy. It was hard to swallow. It doesn't taste the greatest. So what I did was I swallowed it quickly and then drank orange juice right after. You can still taste it after the orange juice, but you just have to think about the fact that it's beneficial for the baby, which is what I did, and I just gulped it down. You have to be careful when it comes to buying cod liver oil. Normally a lot of the cod liver oils that are on the market are highly processed using a lot of heat, and that pretty much damages the vitamins in the cod liver oil, and so they synthetically add vitamin A and vitamin D. So it's, as mentioned earlier, synthetic vitamin A might be what has been linked to birth defects, and so it's best to stay away from highly processed cod liver oil. And so I have linked the cod liver oil that I was taking during my pregnancy and the same cod liver oil that I'm currently giving to my baby in the description section below. If you are in the US, I have also included a secondary option, which is also a great cod liver oil that you could take. And since the recommendation to avoid liver is linked to vitamin A, or it stems from the recommendation of decreasing vitamin A intake, I would also encourage that you eat liver during the pregnancy, as vitamin A is actually beneficial for you, as per my explanation earlier. And liver is one of the most nutrient dense food items on the planet. And so it not only contains vitamin A, but it is also rich in B vitamins, as well as all of the fat soluble vitamins. That's vitamin A, vitamin K, vitamin D, and vitamin E, as well as iron. So it is essential for the baby's organ and system development, and it actually helps with pregnancy fatigue. I personally do not like the taste of liver. I'm actually getting a little bit accustomed to it now as I'm giving it to my son. I am tasting it a little bit, and the way I've been cooking it for him, I think I could tolerate. But because I did not like liver while I was pregnant, what I did was I took liver capsules. And I think those liver capsules are the reason why my iron levels were amazing during my pregnancy. My midwife was actually quite surprised to see my iron levels in the 140s, which are quite rare for a pregnant woman to have her iron in the 140s. And so I truly believe that it was my pregnancy diet, as well as especially these liver capsules, because prior to my pregnancy, I was highly anemic. Yeah, I think I went from like a 7 to a 140, which is insane. Take the liver capsules. I actually purchased the capsules online, and I was taking one a day. If you are interested, I have linked the capsules in the description box below. If you are not like me and you do like the taste of liver, then please enjoy, but make sure that it is from a grass-fed or pasture-raised animal, because liver is our detoxifying organ and it's the same thing for animals. So if they are being fed grains and antibiotics and hormones and everything else, whatever they've detoxified from their system will end up in their liver, which means what you're eating is their toxins. So make sure it is a clean animal, and make sure that it is a grass-fed, grass-finished, pasture-raised animal, which is what I've been giving to my son now that he actually loves the taste of liver. So the other forbidden food is seafood, and that's because of the mercury and PCB content in fish. However, not all fish is high in mercury. Mercury is cumulative, so normally smaller fishes, or fishes that are normally preys, are low in mercury, and that's because the bigger the fish, the more smaller fish it has eaten and the more mercury it has ingested. And so because of that cumulative effect, the bigger fish are the ones that we should be on the lookout for. If you look at this chart, you'll see that halibut, tuna, mackerel are the ones that are high in mercury, while salmon, oysters, sardines, tilapia, sole, haddock, cod, shrimp, and caviar are low in mercury. You can check out my Instagram post to get additional details in regards to mercury in fish, as well as to look at this chart. As for PCBs, the key is to consume wild-caught Alaskan fish. Eating fish twice or more per week is actually beneficial for the brain and nervous system development of the fetus, and that is because it is high in omega-3. And in fact, one of the most nutrient-dense seafoods that you can have is caviar, or fish eggs. Caviar is rich in various vitamins and minerals, and these vitamins and minerals are important for the development of the endocrine system and the nervous system. And actually, in some cultures, it is considered a fertility food. Most people think that caviar is super expensive, but that's not always the case. For example, salmon eggs are reasonably priced, and one serving of caviar is less than one tablespoon. So it could be affordable. And if you're worried about it being raw, then you can purchase it frozen and thaw it prior to consuming it. I personally did not have caviar when I was pregnant, but I have been giving it to my baby now, and he seems to like it, and I've not had any problems even though it's raw. Lastly, raw dairy. Almost every doctor will tell you that raw milk is dangerous and should not be consumed during pregnancy. And that stems from the belief that raw milk can cause Listeria infections, which is a foodborne pathogen which can be quite deadly. However, an FDA report from 2003 showed that there was more illness from Listeria, 500 times more illness from Listeria from deli meat, and 29 times more illness from Listeria from pasteurized milk than raw milk. So how come we are not being cautioned against deli meat? Why aren't we being told deli meat should not be consumed? Or why is deli meat not illegal while raw milk is illegal in places like Canada? What should be avoided is soft, unaged cheese, and that could be raw or pasteurized. Either way, it should be avoided because it is linked to Listeria infections. But raw milk and aged raw cheese is perfectly safe. Full fat raw milk from grass-fed cows is nutrient dense, and it is easily digested and absorbed by our digestive system. Raw milk is actually healthier for you than pasteurized milk, and that is because it still contains the enzymes and good bacteria that protect us from allergies, asthma, infections, and it strengthens our immune system. Also, because raw milk still has the lactase enzyme intact, it helps us digest the lactose in the milk. So this is why it can actually be consumed by people who are lactose intolerant. And it's also important that it is grass-fed and full fat, and that is because it would have more nutrients. So it would have more cholesterol, more choline, more omega-3, more folate, more of the fat-soluble vitamins, which are vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin K, and vitamin E, as well as more CLA. Pasteurization uses high heat, which inactivates and degrades a lot of these nutrients, as well as the useful enzymes and good bacteria. The recommendation is to consume 1,500 milligrams of calcium per day, and that would be about 4 cups of raw milk or 5 to 6 ounces of raw cheese. If you live in Canada or somewhere else where raw milk is illegal, or if you are already pregnant and have never had raw milk before, then it is best to stick to raw cheese, and that's because raw milk takes time to get used to. But if you are not pregnant yet and you have access to raw milk, then make sure that it is from a clean source and enjoy. If you live in the US, I have linked a website below where you can search where you can find raw milk in your state. If you live in California, for example, raw milk is actually regulated and it is sold in retail stores. As for me, I am consuming my raw cheese because I live in Canada and raw milk is still to be legalized. And if you are looking for raw cheese, it is actually quite easy to find. It is even available at Costco. If you look at the ingredient list of any of the hard aged cheese, you will see that the first ingredient is raw milk or unpasteurized milk. And these are normally cheeses from Switzerland, France, or Italy. Some of the cheeses that I have found are Le Gruyère, Emmental, and Grana Padano. All right, so that concludes part one of this two-part series on pregnancy nutrition. I hope that it was informative and that you will be including cod liver oil, liver, seafood, and raw dairy into your pregnancy, breastfeeding, or pre-pregnancy diet. If you want to see part two, where I will be going over all of the other recommended nutrients and food items, then I recommend that you subscribe and hit the bell notification so that you are notified when the next video is uploaded. If you found this video helpful, please share with anybody that you think might be interested in this topic. If you have any other suggestions or topics that you would like to have covered, as always, please let me know in the comment section below. Have a wonderful day and see you on the next video.